If you love liberty, declare your independence by signing the Shire Society Declaration at shiresociety.com.
Good morning and welcome to the Senate Executive Department's Administration Committee. We're going to start the day by opening the public hearing on House Bill 97 and call the prime sponsor, Representative Kirk. Good morning, Representative.
Good morning, Madam Chairman. Good morning, members of the committee. For the record, I'm Neil Kirk, representing the towns of Ware and Deering in Hillsborough District 2. The bill that you have before you is similar to a bill that we had last session, but there have been two or three significant changes, which I hope will turn in favor of a positive recommendation from the committee. The bill is basically divided into two parts. One places limitations on how the government can use drones, and the other places limitations on how individuals and businesses can use drones. The section with respect to the government has not been significantly changed, and it's my understanding that there hasn't been any problems with that. The one change that was made is on page 1, line 13, the definition of critical infrastructure was significantly changed at the request of the Bureau of Aeronautics to make it comply more with Federal Aviation Administration procedures. The section on individual business use of drones has been changed in two significant ways. Number one, page 4, lines 34 and 35. There is a specific exemption for the unintentional recording or viewing of an individual. The previous version of the bill did not have an exception for unintentional or accidental violations. For example, a drone flying over your property appropriately inadvertently captures images of somebody else on the abutting property. As long as this was accidental, unintentional, it's not a violation. Some real estate folks were concerned about that, and so this exemption was put in. The other and the most significant change occurs on page 5, lines 13 through 18. It exempts from three sections of the bill a whole variety of individual and business uses. The sections from which it's exempted are on page 4, lines 20 through 35. There, basically, it says a person can't use a drone to engage in automated surveillance, which means tracking the person without somebody at the controls of the drone using some sort of a program. Number 2, surveillance for commercial purposes. Surveillance, again, is tracking or following. It's not just taking pictures. Tracking or following without the prior consent of the people being tracked or followed. And 3, says you can't take a picture using a drone of a person on his own property where he has an expectation of privacy. Those three sections are not applicable under page 5, lines 13 through 18. If it is a person engaged in a business or profession licensed by the state or by an agent, employee, or contractor of such person, if the drone is used solely to perform reasonable tasks within the scope of practice or activities permitted under the person's license, and this is the key area, provided that the drone shall not be used to obtain information about the identity, conduct, movements, etc., of an individual. In other words, a business that is licensed to do business can operate without compliance with sections 1, Roman 1, 2, and 3, provided that the use of the drone is related to its business, legitimate business purposes, and that it's not using the drone to capture pictures of identifiable people. This was worked out after a great deal of negotiation with a variety of people. There are two organizations that did not agree to this, and that's basically State Farm and Comcast. Their lobbyists said, and I had a lot of meetings with them afterwards, they basically don't want any regulation. Those are the substantive changes, Madam Chairman, in the bill. As you know, and perhaps some of your committee members know who were here last session, This bill has passed the House on several occasions. Last session, went to a committee of conference and died there. I'm hopeful that this new language will find support in the Senate as it did in the House. That completes my testimony, Madam Chairman. I'd be pleased to answer any questions.
Thank you very much for your testimony. Are there any questions from the committee? Seeing none, thank you very much.
Thank you.
The chair will call Representative McGuire. Good morning, Madam Chair.
Good morning, Madam Chair, members of the committee. I'm Carolyn McGuire, representing Merrimack District 29. And Representative Kirk did cover most of the things I intended to, but I wanted to emphasize that the amendment the House made was partly to alleviate the concerns about conflicting with federal law. So we, instead of defining critical infrastructure ourselves and trying to enforce it, we've put in the language that the Department of Aeronautics will identify according to the FAA procedures, and they will enforce the critical infrastructure rules, which they are doing now around airports and so forth. And the other one was to balance the privacy of individuals with the business use of drones, which is large and growing. We did not want to eliminate, say, a drone flying around to show you the view from your from the house that you're trying to sell, or taking pictures of runners in a race so that they can get their awards or whatever. And we believe the language does that. There are still some restrictions. And the main one is that no one can operate a weaponized drone, which is, we think that should not be allowed, except for military contractors trying it out on their own land, which is not what we're worried about. Police can't use a weaponized drone, and individuals cannot. And other than that, it's largely what we did before, but this language is a fairly successful compromise between a great many people that objected to the original language because of restricted business uses.
Okay, thank you very much for your testimony. Are there any questions? Seeing none, thank you very much. Okay, let's see. We'll start with Anna Brown.
My name is Anna Brown, and I'm here today on behalf of Citizens Count New Hampshire. We're a nonpartisan nonprofit dedicated to making it easier for citizens to engage with their elected officials. So we don't take any positions as an organization, but we do inform citizens about upcoming bills and invite them to share their opinions on their website and Facebook page. On March 18th, we asked our community, should drones be prohibited from flying or taking pictures over private property without permission? Using Facebook and website tools, we isolated responses from New Hampshire, and I'm summarizing the comments here for you today as a form of citizen testimony. A total of 458 New Hampshire residents participated in the discussion, and about 84% support requiring permission for drones. The packets include a copy of all the comments we received, which gives you more insight into how residents are thinking about this issue, and it also has more information on our process. I'm also happy to answer any questions you might have now.
Okay, thank you very much. Are there any questions from the committee? Seeing none, thank you. Okay, the chair will call Jim Cloutier.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Madam Chair, members of the committee, thank you for the time. I am way out of my comfort zone, so please forgive me if I need to stop and collect myself. My name is Jim Cloutier. My wife, Carol, and I are residents of Auburn, New Hampshire. We own a small business called Red Dog Aerial Media, and it is a UAV drone services company. I'm speaking this morning in opposition to HB 97. In order to make this a little more brief, I'm going to go ahead and skip the first couple of paragraphs in the written statement that you guys have. What is the intent of HB 97? I'm an engineer, so I needed to break it down into numbers. So what I did is I took the entire bill. There are 32, if you don't include the definitions, there are 32 individual items in this bill that are directly related to the use of the UAV. I've added each one of those items into six categories, and I've broken them down into evidence or information gathering, privacy, which includes surveillance, stalking, and privacy concerns, operational or FAA, records retention, which would include retention of digital media, reporting and disclosure, and also miscellaneous, which would include the weaponizing, training, and liability that's mentioned. The top three categories presented in this bill are either addressed by the Fourth Amendment, the current New Hampshire law, or in some cases both. The top three categories, evidence and information gathering, which would be one, privacy, which would be the second, and the operational FAA, those top three categories make up 75% of this bill. So there's quite a bit of redundancy, and we feel the redundancy of HB 97 creates more confusion than it does in solving a specific set of problems. I'd like to address the privacy issue specifically because it's referred to so prominently in this bill. I acknowledge that privacy concerns are valid, and they always have been. When cameras became a standard in most cell phones, there were privacy concerns based on bad behavior. People were caught taking photos in what we considered at the time as private areas, locker rooms, dressing rooms, etc. The response was to modify and strengthen the privacy law. It was not... And it was the intent to protect people from criminal intent. It was not to create a cell phone bill at the time. We weren't chasing the technology. This may, HB 97 approaches a privacy concern by regulating the technology with the expectation that it will protect against criminal intent. This may actually create the opposite. The authors of this bill have redefined the reasonable expectation of privacy on privately owned real property in 422D3, subparagraph 3A. This definition is now inconsistent with the privacy definition in RSA 644-9, violation of privacy within the criminal code. In fact, in regards to viewing someone, the privacy law defines view as looking at another person with the unaided eye or any device intended to improve visual acuity, which would include something that's up on a drone. The more you define privacy outside of an existing law used to protect someone's privacy, the more you weaken that existing law. If current laws are not deemed adequate to protect the citizens of New Hampshire because of the introduction of new technology, then those laws need to be changed or they need to be reinforced. Have there been issues with UAVs in the state of New Hampshire? I would say yes. However, with proper education, we feel these issues can be avoided. The FAA has made significant strides to ensure that UAV flights have been integrated into the national airspace safely, and they still have quite a bit to do. Regulation is pretty much useless without education. Any consumer can stop by a hobby store, purchase a $500 UAV that has an effective range of over 1 mile, and they have no idea that he or she cannot fly it within 5 miles of an airport. It would never even occur to them. In addition, unless the hobby store has included a before you fly information from the FAA, with the purchase, they probably won't even know that they're required to register it. In many cases, local law enforcement officers have the same issue. Even if our law enforcement could issue citations, how many officers actually know what the regulations are? How do we make the state of New Hampshire safer when it comes to UAV flights? You start with proper education for law enforcement and a public awareness program. The use of this technology will continue to grow by leaps and bounds. If we approach it in a constructive and collaborative way, we can create a culture of safety and also demonstrate to UAV development companies that New Hampshire would be a welcome place for their business. This is a $127 billion worldwide business by 2020, and I think that figure was conservative. Thank you for your opportunity to speak this morning. I'd be more than happy to answer any questions you may have.
Thank you very much for your testimony this morning. Are there any questions from the committee? Seeing none, thank you. Thank you. The chair will call Henry Bayou.
Madam Chair, and for the record, my name is Henry Bayou, and I'm here on behalf of the Consumer Technology Association. The Consumer Technology Association represents more than 2,200 companies, 80% of which are small businesses and startups. And the Consumer Technology Association has been working with the FAA on regulations regarding drones. We've also worked with other organizations in the FAA in the Know Before You Fly campaign, which is an effort to educate folks that use drones on protocols and the laws regarding drones. And many of the manufacturers now, when you open the box and take the drone out, on the top is an informational packet. And one of the first things you're supposed to do is register the drone for the FAA. The drones have an identification number on it, and whether you're using it for commercial purposes or as a hobbyist, you're supposed to register it with the FAA so people know whose drone it is if it's in operation. The Consumer Technology Association has a number of issues with this bill. One, a number of things in this bill are preempted by federal law and the FAA. And then we also feel that there are other provisions that basically are covered by current law. There are a section of this bill deals with prohibiting the use of drones over critical infrastructure. Which would be airports, it could be prisons, could be electric facilities. And last summer, Congress passed Public Law 114-190, and if you look at the side that has section 2209 on it, look at the reverse, 2209, and applications for designation, if you look at that, it describes the process so that 180 days after this law is enacted, the FAA is supposed to put together rules for designation of facilities as critical infrastructure. And we're in the process of doing that. So there will be a process in place for instance, that the state of New Hampshire wants to make sure that the prison is designated as a critical infrastructure where you want to limit flight or prohibit flight, you apply to the FAA, and they will act as sort of a clearinghouse, which makes much more sense to have one clearinghouse so that folks that are operating drones can go to that one clearinghouse and find out where limitations are for the operation of drones. The FAA regulates airspace, and so it makes more sense to have them regulating use around critical infrastructure. Representative Kirk described, he mentioned there are a number of exemptions for commercial uses. I think what he and the sponsors are trying to get at is to make sure that people's privacy is protected, that they're not harassed, that they're not stalked, and that their privacy is protected. And I think that everyone agrees that that should occur. We would argue that there are already current laws that address this. RSA 644-9 deals with privacy, and it speaks to using any device, which we think is a more appropriate and not technology specific. This bill speaks specifically to drones. And who knows within the next 5 to 10 years what kind of technology is going to be developed where someone could use it to invade someone's privacy. So we think the better approach is to use this statute that's on the books. If it needs to be broadened a little bit, we'd be in favor of that. But I think making it technology specific is not appropriate. There are also statutes regarding harassment and stalking. And so if someone feels their privacy is being violated or they're harassed or stalked, they can call the local police right now and have those issues addressed. So be happy to answer any questions.
Okay. Thank you very much for your testimony. Are there any questions? Senator Reagan.
So you agree there's no conflict with federal statutes in this bill?
Well, the FAA did say, with regards to some of the privacy sections, it did say, HB 97 proposes drone-specific prohibitions on privacy. Specifically, proposed section 422B3 would prohibit the use of drones to take pictures of individuals, and proposed section 422B37 would prohibit the use of a drone to stalk or harass a person. The FAA has previously noted that similar prohibitions directed solely at drones constitute operational restrictions which are preempted. So there are a number of provisions, I think, that are preempted by the federal law. But as to be conflicting, I don't necessarily think they conflict, but preempted.
Are there any further questions? Seeing none. Oh, Senator Susie?
Yeah. Looking at the second page of your letter, Mr. Bate, about creating no-fly zones that don't already exist, is the concern that we're going to have both federal no-fly zone areas and state no-fly zone areas and an inability to determine?
Yeah, again.
Which is which? Is that why you're suggesting we defer to the federal?
It certainly makes much more sense to have one clearinghouse to go to if you're a drone operator to find out where the no-fly zones are. The FAA is going to be doing that rather than have state-specific no-fly zones. There is going to be a process in place for either the state or if it's electric utility or some facility that wants to have a no-fly zone to apply to the FAA to be designated as a no-fly zone. So I think to answer your question, the complexity involved with having a number of clearinghouses to go to find out where the no-fly zones is really makes it problematic.
Thank you. I have a question, and it's really kind of a hypothetical question. As you know, we have landowners up in the North Country that own hundreds, if not thousands, of acres. They open them up for current use, and people will go in and they'll go hiking and so on and so forth. They're walking trails throughout their property. It is considered to be private property that's open for public use. So say someone gets lost in the middle of the forest and the police want to use a drone to try to locate that person, but the person who owns the property says, no, I don't want you flying the drone over my property. What happens in that kind of a situation?
Exactly. I mean, there are a number of applications of drones. They're being used in more and more instances. And so I think the bill before you has sort of a chilling effect on the good use of drones. So certainly if someone's using them inappropriately, there are laws on the books that can address that. But what this bill could tend to do is have a chilling effect on drones in general.
Thank you. Are there any further questions? Seeing none, thank you. The chair will call Chris, is it?
Rimber.
Rimber, okay.
Thank you.
You can sit right there, just to make sure if you're going to speak, Mr. Colantuno, that you identify yourself for the record.
Madam Chairman, the issue I have with the bill is a very simple one. My customers are very simple, the police and fire and EMS.
I'm sorry, sir. Could you please identify yourself for the record?
Oh, I'm sorry. My name is Chris Brimberg. I am the chairman and CEO of Brimberg Aerospace. Okay, I'm talking about the bill 97, and my questions are is very simple. My customers are law enforcement, fire, police, government agencies, Boston utilities, and the Department of Transportation. What the question is this. If I go in and they want to use my services, it's called a wet or dry lease. So they either decide to have me along on a wet lease or a dry lease, or they decide to rent the device itself. If they go out and do this and they suddenly take pictures, you're saying automated means video. My problem is that I need a liability issue, because if the police have a search warrant, they go in and take pictures. The question is, what am I covered for? Because I have liability for insurance, but where am I, if there are any questions, coming back as a contractor? I've worked in Miami for an agency called HIDA for over 15 years as a contractor in the 90s, and what we do is, as a contractor, anyone, Booz Allen, we want to have some type of legal ramification from you folks, the legislators, so in case something happens. And the biggest concern is how you wrote this. Now, I've been hearing things and testimonies. First of all, I don't know how many people of these are pilots, but I am. I'm also an MRO graduate student. I have other degrees, but what I'm going to tell you is this. The FAA has made it very clear. The airspace above the NSA is called is theirs. Now, I heard just testimony about you asked a hypothetical question, okay? And that hypothetical question I can answer you from the FAA point is, if the person with property says no, the FAA is going to say, go ahead and do it. Because they're going to say is, there's a clear and present danger, imminent situation, but we own the airspace. And the FAA and the feds can walk in and say, that's the situation. Because they do own the airspace. And Ms. Lambert and Ms. Hunt, who's going to testify later, will tell you the same thing. They own it. It's their airspace. Now, what they're saying is, the states and the feds want to work together in the FAA. Now, I also want to tell something else about this testimony. In a very short time, the FAA is going to take the weight limit, 55 pounds, and they're going to change it, meaning that they're going to have licenses for people to go above that. So that's something you're going to have to take into account that's going to happen very shortly. You might have a 727 taking off from Concord that has no manned aircraft, meaning is there's no one on board. It's a cargo, like FedEx aircraft. And these are things that are now coming. But the point I'm trying to make is, of all the people I've seen testimony, I'm the one that has all the certificates, if you look on my website. But the point is, the FAA does own that airspace. Now, I understand concerns, other things, but the reason I brought legal, because we're concerned, is that what happens if I am employed by the fire department? I go into, and the drone goes in, and let's just take an example. I'm sent in there, the drone's sent in there to look for a kid. The kid, we can't find the kid, the house destroys, parents go, they're grieving, and they decide to sue the city of Concord. Let's just say it's the city of Concord. What type of, not liability, but what kind of insurances I have that I'm not going to be caught in a situation that, let's say, Concord is under a lawsuit, that I'm going to be sued at the same time. Because this gives me the ability to do my job. Because you might have a grandchild who goes walking out in the middle of the woods in the summer or winter, you want us to find it. I have to have some type. It's like in most states, you have a law that says Good Samaritan. Okay? That's what I'm looking for. Something that says that I can cover. I'm not here for money. I'm here to help the public, but to help the police department, fire department, give them the tools they need to do the job. Do you have questions for me?
If I could just elaborate a little bit.
Mr. Palatuno, please identify yourself
for the record. Attorney Thomas Palatuno, representing Brinberg Aerospace. The specific concern we have is that the private non-governmental use of drones is subject to the criminal penalty of a misdemeanor. There's a violation of 422 D3, 1, 2, and 3. So our client's concern is that if the government agency hires the client to use the client's drone, in other words, they're not using their own drone, are they protected? And it's not clear in my reading of the law, there's not a dovetail that protects the private owner of the drone when it's being hired by the government agency. I think the intent is clear that a government agency can do the certain things that are listed, that the representative Kirk talked about. But the private drone owner cannot do all those things. So to me, reading the bill, maybe it just wasn't thought through to get the protection, but there's not a clear protection for the private drone owner who is leasing a drone to a government agency. So that's what we'd like to see for his protection.
Thank you. Are there any questions? I have a question for you. You said that you oftentimes lease your equipment to police and fire departments for a variety of different reasons. And one of the themes that keep emerging concerning drone bills is really about protecting an individual's privacy, people having drones follow them, and right. So on and so forth. But do you think there should be provisions that would prevent an individual from following the police?
Excuse me, I just want to make clear that he's a new startup business.
Yeah, so. No, that's okay, because I mean, he's in the business. So we've heard about people being very concerned about the police using drones to stop them, to follow them, to survey them. But what about people doing the same thing to the police department?
Okay, well, my answer is a simple one. Is that there be provision in my company for pro bono work? So if there is a police problem, and you're having a problem with police, I will police them. Meaning is that I will be at the aid of that agency or nonprofit. Let's just say Concord Police tomorrow shoots a young black man, and it's a 15-year-old, and there's going to be some type of protest or something else against it. Or you want me to be up because you are worried about police problems. Yes, I would be able to be on the payroll to do that, yes.
Okay. Thank you. Are there any further questions? Seeing none, thank you very much for your testimony this morning. The chair will call Matt Nincieli.
Oh, that's right. I didn't know if you're not sticking that well. Then. Good morning, Madam Chair. Three of the members of the committee. Thank you for the opportunity to testify. My name is Matt Nincieli. I'm the Northeast Region Executive Director for TechNet. TechNet's a trade association made up of over 70 of the nation's leading technology and innovation companies. This is an issue that we worked on last year on a different committee, but with you, Madam Chair. And again, you know, this is an issue we've worked on across the country in many states. Drones is an important and growing part of the technology ecosystem, as we like to call it. You've heard how it's such a growing industry, and so that this, you know, this is a very significant issue for us as a technology industry, and we would like to see the commercial exemption that was put in by the Senate last session. We would like to see that again. We understand that there's three buckets of drone potential drone regulation. There's the government rules, and we understand if the government would like to self-regulate, the government you're part of, we understand that the desire to do that. Then there's the hobbyist bucket, and the FAA has put in more regulations on hobbyist use, and we also believe that hobbyist uses, there's already a lot of privacy protections that the sponsor and the bill is looking to achieve are already in New Hampshire law, whether it's the stalking or harassment laws. And we think those are covered in large part by current state law. And then there's the commercial bucket. Few, if any, states have attempted to regulate the commercial use of drones. We believe that if New Hampshire did this, it would have an impact on the industry, not just for the large companies. I think for large companies, you have a concern of a patchwork of regulations from what if New Hampshire does something, Vermont does something else, Massachusetts does something else, you create quite the a burden on large companies. The sponsor mentioned two large companies that use drones and said that they don't want any restrictions. I would argue that that's not fully accurate. The FAA does regulate many parts of drone use, and there are many restrictions on companies' commercial use of drones. I think too that the concern of commercial use of drones, a lot of that is kind of a fear of commercial abuse of drones, where we haven't really seen any. I don't think there's much evidence, if any, of commercial abuses of drones. It's not in a commercial company benefit to abuse drones. It's not good for business. It's not good for their reputation. So I don't see the benefit there in the abuse, any abuse of drones, if there was even the potential of that. The drone technology has improved vastly. There are many self-regulations that the commercial industry puts on themselves, and the FAA laws have made it very clear what commercial companies can use drones for. And those are the large companies that that operate and use drones throughout the country. But for small companies, as we've heard testimony earlier, I think that any commercial restrictions on drones would make it harder for small companies to embrace some of the new drone technology, grow their business here, employ folks here. It's not just the big Amazons of the world that are using drones now. There are many small companies popping up all over the state, all over the country, that are using drones. So I think that I would respectfully ask that this committee really think about where they want to go with regulating drones. Think about what the FAA has already done, continue to do. This is one area where I don't think state governments can say, well, we're tired of waiting for the federal government to do anything. The FAA continually updates their rules and procedures and policies. They did it as recently as, I think, less than a year ago. They updated, updated their rules that you heard Henry mention a little bit about some of the new rules. So we would ask again that the commercial safe harbor that the committee, that the Senate put in last year, that you consider doing that again if this bill was to move forward. So thank you for your time. I appreciate the opportunity.
Thank you very much for your testimony. Are there any questions from the committee? Seeing none, thank you very much. The chair will call Ian Freeman.
Good morning, I'm Ian Freeman, one of the co-chairs of the New Hampshire Liberty Party. Privacy is definitely very important. However, we don't need the government to create extra rules to protect it. It's the individual's responsibility to protect their own privacy. As you know, I operate a camera on a regular basis inside this state house and sometimes outside, depending on newsworthy circumstances and things like that. Whether the camera's in my hands or whether the camera is flying due to a remote control device shouldn't change the rules of engagement as far as if I'm somewhere that I'm allowed to be recording things that are happening in public. I've seen that there is a certain attitude among some people that they believe they have privacy when they're walking around in public, and they don't. I don't intend to record private people in public. That's not what I do. But if there's news happening and someone is nearby or happens to be in the vicinity of that, I'm not going to stop to ask their permission to get them in the shot. That's just, normally I will be respectful of what someone's wishes are, but there are certain circumstances where that's not going to happen. If you want privacy, there are ways to secure that for yourself. If you're on your private property, close your blinds. I don't recommend anyone stand outside of someone's house with a video camera and try to record, but technically that should be legal. Again, it should be up to the individual to protect themselves. And so one of the big concerns about this bill is that commercial purposes would not be allowed. You wouldn't be able to, the way I read it, you wouldn't be able to, say you owned a shopping center, an outdoor shopping center. You can't use a drone for surveillance purposes on your own property without getting permission from every single person you want to record that's in this bill. The way I read it, that seems crazy to me. I mean, we've got so many different private properties where there's multiple security cameras that are installed for good reason around that property, and nobody has to ask permission of every customer that walks into the store or every person that's walking around an open-air shopping area to be recorded. You're not on your private property, so you're subject to the other private property's wishes as far as their own surveillance. And if that private property owner wants to have somebody in the security department operating a drone and flying it around in order to keep things safe and secure on their property, they should have an absolute right to do that. So I think this bill, you know, while I agree with the intentions as far as restricting government's use of drones, that aspect of this I agree with, I can't say, you know, one way or the other that I don't think this overall is a good bill, because it restricts the private individual, it restricts commercial purposes, and it puts the onus on the drone operator rather than the person who wishes to have privacy. If you don't want to be seen, wear a mask or close your blinds. So thank you. That's all I have to say. Thanks for listening.
Thank you very much, Mr. Freeman. Are there any questions? Seeing none, thank you. The chair will call Daryl Perry.
Good morning, thank you. For the record, Daryl Perry, CEO of Liberty Lobby LLC. And like Mr. Freeman, I think that this should really only apply to governments. I think if you're going to pass this, a good amendment would be to strike everything that is not 422D:1, 2, or 9. There are already, as has already been mentioned previously, there are already federal regulations on private use of drones, and this actually goes a lot further than the federal regulations. Federal regulations on if I have a drone only applies if my drone weighs over, I believe it's half a pound. I actually have a friend who built a drone less than the federal weight limit so that he didn't have to go through the regulations of getting it registered, having to put an ID number on it, and he actually flew it inside at a convention, flew it inside the vendor area of the Radisson Hotel down in Manchester. Now, under this, he would have to call the owner of the Radisson and then say that he had a legally recognized interest in violating the privacy rights of the people in the vendor's area to be able to fly his drone around just to get some really neat video. And then he would be subject to a misdemeanor. The bill does not specify if that would be Class A or Class B, so could be something up to 1 year in incarceration simply for flying inside what is, you know, open to the public but still on private property. Speaking of the identification requirements, again, the FAA requires that you register your drone and then you get the ID number, similar to what goes on an airplane or helicopter. This goes further and says that you have to put your name, your address, and your telephone number in addition to that federal number that has all of that info connected to it anyway. Again, if you're going to pass this, and I want to reiterate that I see this as slightly better than previous bills on the topic that have come forth, but if you're going to pass this, it should only apply to governments. It should not apply to private individuals, because there are already federal regulations, and pretty much everything that, you know, the stalking, the harassing, the other stuff, that's already illegal. As was mentioned, people didn't make anti-cell phone bills when cell phones came out because somebody used the camera on the smartphone to take a picture that they should not have taken. So definitely take out everything regarding individuals, and I'll answer any questions.
Thank you very much for your testimony. Are there any questions? Seeing none, thank you. The chair will call Christopher Wade.
Hi, I'm Christopher Lee from Keene, New Hampshire, and I don't have a whole lot to say because there's Daryl and a bunch of other people here have already said most of it. But I do want to make one comment about police and the use of drones to follow police. Well, police are actually already under extreme public scrutiny under the law. There's been multiple Supreme Court rulings. You can record them without their knowledge, and that's completely legal. And no law in New Hampshire can override that, from what I understand. So as far as that's concerned, nothing you guys will do will really change that anyway. But as far as the public is concerned, you don't have any rights. You don't have any privacy rights in public. And it doesn't matter whether you're on your own property or not. That may still need to be decided by the U.S. Supreme Court anyway. In New Hampshire, the law is a little bit different. But I'll say the regulation as far as the main thing I wanted to say was the regulation as far as putting the name on the drone is a duplication, but I don't think we should have that anyway. I think we should look towards eliminating that. That's an issue of the drone user themselves. And I think we're kind of overlooking the fact that the drone user should have some level of privacy as well, not just your ordinary person going along their daily business. That's all.
Okay. Thank you very much for your testimony. Are there any questions? Seeing none, thank you very much, Mr. Wade. The chair will call Representative Cushing.
Thank you, Madam Chair, members of the committee. For the record, I'm Representative Randy Cushing from Washington District 21, and I appear here in support of House Bill 97. What House Bill 97 really is an attempt to recognize the changes in technology require our continually adapting our laws to reinforce what I think are really traditional values that we have. And what at the heart of what this is about the right to be, this deals with the matter of trespass. Our technology has evolved to the point where someone does not need to physically trespass upon the person or property of someone else in order to violate the private space. You can have a situation now, there was a time when you think if you close the doors and you're in your own bedroom, that you're all set, that no one can come and violate your castle. Well, nowadays you can do that by virtual trespass through the advances in technology. So what I think Representative Kirk has done is take that traditional respect or prohibition against trespass and crafted legislation that will adopt to changing technology. And I think it's an important piece of legislation. I understand that the FAA claims a role to regulate safety of the airspace, but what in New Hampshire what we're really concerned about is the right to regulate privacy, to protect ourselves. The fundamental essence of freedom to me is the right to be left alone, and be it by the government or be it by another individual. We have the right to be left alone, and what this legislation will do is to protect that. I'm concerned about a number of issues. Specifically, as someone who serves on the Criminal Justice Committee, I've been aware for a number of years of the problem at the state prison, the lack of with drones flying and violating prison space, which causes the prison to go to lockdown mode. It's not against the law. It's against the law to bring contraband in, but it's not against the law to do that. By recognizing that prisons are critical infrastructure and giving the state the power to regulate that, we enhance public safety, not just about that. And that's what the FAA does not do. Madam Chair, you referenced your hypothetical question about someone. Under this statute, under this bill as proposed, it would be an exigent circumstance, an emergency, where our law enforcement could use a drone to overfly someone's live tract of land and find people there. I know there's other people speaking, but I just want to urge this committee to take this bill as it is and pass it on.
Thank you very much, Representative.
Are
there any questions? Senator Susie.
Thank you very much, Representative Cushing. Could you address the issue that several previous speakers have raised about our current privacy laws and this creating a whole separate class, and why this is or isn't necessary, or why you didn't choose to amend the existing criminal statutes?
Well, you know, I think we currently have laws against trespass too, but I think that the change in technology constantly require us to fine-tune our legislation so that we're specifically talking about that. Someone can say that, no, that doesn't, you know, that's stalking law. It's actually when a drone hovers over somebody else, it's not really stalking, even though it's following along. We're looking at trying to take this new technology that didn't exist and try to adapt legislation for that. I don't think that our current law, any more than, you know, we took it upon ourselves. One might have thought that reckless operation of a motor vehicle would be somebody who is texting on a cell phone or talking on a cell phone. When we did reckless operation laws, cell phones did not exist. We found out that some people assert that, in fact, it was not reckless operation to be texting or to be talking on a cell phone, so it was necessary for us to pass legislation that, again, you know, reflected changes in technology, but were consistent with public safety. And I think that's what this bill intends to do. And I also think that, you know, because I know there's some questions raised about whether it should be strictly to government or to the private sector, you know, I don't want to see the government outsourcing its to the private sector violations of the privacy of individuals. I think this strikes a good balance, by the way.
Are there any further questions? I would just like to read to you. Criminal Code is Title 62, I think, and it is Chapter 644, breaches of the peace and related offenses. This is already statute. So a person is guilty of a Class A misdemeanor if such person unlawfully and without the consent of the persons entitled to privacy therein installs and uses. There's the first section which talks about this, any device for the purpose of observing, photographing, recording, amplifying, broadcasting, or in any way transmitting images or sounds of the body parts of a person, including, and then it lists specific body parts. In section B, it says, in any private place, any device for the purposes of observing, photographing, recording, amplifying, or broadcasting, or in any other way transmitting images or sounds in such a place, or C, outside a private place, any device for the purpose of hearing, recording, amplifying, broadcasting, observing, or in any way transmitting images, location, movement, or sounds originating in such a place that would not ordinarily be audible, visible, or comprehensible outside of such a place. Section 2 says, as in this section, private place means a place where one may reasonably expect to be safe from surveillance, including public restrooms, locker rooms, or the interior of one's dwelling place, and it goes on to say, talk about a person's body parts. You go down to section 4, and it says, a person is guilty of a misdemeanor if such person knowingly enters any residential curtilage as defined in RSA 627:9i, or in any other private place as defined in paragraph 2 of this section, without lawful authority, and looks into the residential structure thereon or any other private place with no legitimate purpose. Can you please tell me why we need to recreate a statute just for drones when it appears that a person's privacy is already protected under our existing statutes?
Well, respectfully, Madam Chair, I read that quickly. I haven't refreshed my memory on that.
I don't mean to put you on the hot seat either, but it appears with 644:9 that privacy for an individual is already protected. And my question to you is, why do we need to create another statute specifically to protect privacy from drones? Because here it says any device, and that would include drones.
Respectfully, I'll read the statute and I'll respond to I like to be able to read what I'm just responding.
So I look forward to
an email from you that will make sure to be included into
the bill file.
Thank you.
Okay. Are there any further questions? Seeing none, thank you very much, Representative. The chair will call George Roussos. Good morning, Mr. Roussos.
Good morning, Madam Chair, members of the committee. Thank you very much. The record, George Roussos, with the law firm of Bornadino and Concord. I am here representing the New Hampshire Association of Domestic Insurance Companies and the American Insurance Association. My clients are using drones currently. They're going to use them a lot more in the future. It is great new technology to promote public safety, to enable companies to do their jobs more efficiently, and to address particularly insurance claims more promptly. It is technology that is going to be increasingly useful. And our concern is that this bill will inhibit something that government should be encouraging right now, which is the expanded use of this technology. The applications are growing, but some clear ones, for example, are dangerous activities such as reviewing roofs of commercial structures where otherwise someone would have to get up there and survey the roof, either to decide whether to write an insurance policy or to decide to adjust a claim where there's been damage to the roof. These drones can do that really efficiently. A few years ago, we had hailstorms over on the Seacoast area that did a lot of property damage to a lot of, and we had to bring in adjusters from all of New England to deal with claims. Had drones been available, that damage could have been surveyed very efficiently, and the delays that were intended to paying people for their losses would have been reduced considerably. These are just a couple of areas. Looking at property that's otherwise inaccessible in the North Country, for example, commercial properties that you want to survey before you decide whether to write or after there's a loss. The uses are growing and will continue to grow, but if this bill passes, that's going to create a problem. And as has been pointed out, the bill creates criminal penalties for violation, misdemeanor penalties, and that's a serious thing. My clients, when they're deciding whether to engage in certain activity, are going to be chilled from doing certain things because of the risk that this bill would be interpreted to put them in a position of facing criminal prosecution. They're just not going to take that chance. The specific issues that we have with this bill, and I won't go into a lot of detail. I'd be happy to follow up if the committee's interested, but there is an attempt to create a commercial exemption. At page 5, it's 422D3, paragraph 8, starting at line 13, is a recognition, I think, that commercial uses are proper. But it goes too far in restricting them. First of all, it permits a person engaged in business or professional activity licensed by the state to do certain things. This is a technical objection, but it could be cured, but as it is, it limits a whole segment of insurance companies that are not licensed. They're what's known as approved surplus lines companies, and they do the same things that other companies do. So again, this is something that my clients caught that could be changed, but as it reads, it would prevent a big segment of insurance from engaging in drone activity. More importantly, there is a prohibition in the lines I referred to against surveillance This is something that we've tried to get changed unsuccessfully in the House, but it's important. Insurance companies, for purposes of fraud investigations, for purposes, for example, of workers' compensation injuries, when a person is claiming that he or she is still unable to lift or do certain activities, it is a common practice today to have someone conduct what you would call surveillance to view the activities of that person and sometimes film them lifting a garage door or going bowling or something when they say they can't do anything. That protects everyone by minimizing fraud and insurance claims. Those activities would be prohibited under this bill. So, if there is a problem with existing law, and as far as I can tell, as has been mentioned, the trespass laws and the privacy laws are adequate, but if they're not, I would suggest you address those laws, not pick out drones for special treatment. The final thing I'd like to say is that in all the testimony that I heard last year, and in the House testimony this year, and in what I've read, I'm not an expert on this, but I haven't heard a thing about a problem involving privacy or safety with respect to the commercial use of drones. These are professionals, pilots fly them, they're licensed with the FAA, their interests are not invading someone's privacy, but in getting information that helps them do their job. You can say, well, there may be a problem, but it's better to know, have a problem, and then know what it is, and then address it surgically and completely. And we have no evidence that I'm aware of that there's a problem with respect to commercial use. So I don't think this bill serves any necessary purpose, and it will do harm, in our view, to commercial use.
Thank you very much for your testimony, Mr. Russo. Are there any questions from the committee? Seeing none, thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, everyone who has signed up to speak has spoken. Is there any other member of the public that would like to briefly speak on this issue? Okay, I'm going to go ahead and close the public hearing on House Bill 97.
We'd like to invite you to visit freekeen.com. Freekeen.com features audio, video, and blogs chronicling the transition to a voluntary society. Freekeen.com also has comments and discussion forums so you can be heard. Freekeen.com.
I should be in Keene, New Hampshire with the Free Staters.